Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for inviting me to the Global Landscape Forum and to review the biodiversity situation. Globally, biodiversity is declining at an unprecedented rate. Over the past half century, we have lost more than two-thirds of the animal population monitored, and the freshwater biodiversity have taken the hardest hit. In China, the challenge is equally severe. The young fish and fish eggs of the Yangtze River have dropped by about 90%. We're glad to see that many countries have stepped up their efforts to combat biodiversity loss, including China, with the world's largest reforest project going on. We're glad to see that many countries have stepped up their efforts to combat biodiversity loss. In China, we have rolled out the world's largest reforestation project. And over the past several years, the spending on biodiversity protection have been increased dramatically. And we have just launched a 10-year fishing ban across the entire Yangtze River. Still, we need to understand that globally, the pressure driving the decline is still persistent, even intensifying. I think much of that is because today the biodiversity pressure is not just coming from local factors, but it is intertwined with this very complex globalized manufacturing, sourcing, and investment, and even consumption. With this situation, we have to extensively broaden the participation from stakeholders globally. But one of the major obstacles is that while many people heard about this, they have heard about this term biodiversity, but most of them actually don't understand the meaning of it. To help the public build awareness on biodiversity, we have just launched a new project called Biodiversity Map. We hope to tap into the new IT technology, the mapping technology, to help people visualize this issue, to help all this information on biodiversity spread beyond the scope of the experts, policy experts, and scientists. The big data platform means to put all the red line zones and protected areas, which account for about 25% of the landmass in China, on digital map, and cross-link them with the knowledge and information on the species they protect, and overlaying that with the air quality, water quality, and with the performance records of millions of factories. It will help people take the stock on what we have got, what we are trying to protect, and what is in danger. The big data solution have already helped with China's pollution control efforts with the 1.8 million records of violations openly accessible in our database, and with the words first real-time disclosure of online monitoring data for tens of thousands of some of the largest emitters available. All this performance data have enabled the public supervision and empowered public supervision and enabled market solutions like green supply chain and green finance. And this has helped with the improvement of air quality, with the concentration of PM2.5 in Beijing dropping by half since 2013. The most exciting function of the map is to enable users to take a picture of any animals and plants and to instantly recognize the species, the name of the species, through artificial intelligence technology, and to enable them to pull out all the information and knowledge about it. The photo will be uploaded on a digital map and contribute to crowdsourcing based citizen science study of all the migration and habitats. It also means to facilitate the public to report illegal wildlife trafficking. Ladies and gentlemen, COP15 will be hosted in China next year. I hope we can overcome the pandemic at that time and gather in Kunming to reveal how to build a more transparent participatory multi-stakeholder mechanism. I trust that that such a mechanism will enable all of us to work together to build a shared future for all life on our beautiful planet Earth. Thank you.